we see so many times, you know, this kind of, I don't know, dark cloud when we think about ballet and we think about what you athletes go through, you know, even though it looks so pretty and, you know, elegant and dainty, like we know those feet are bleeding, you know, we know those bones are nearly breaking and those muscles mm-hmm. are aching. And it just seems like such a taxing, you know, sport and such a taxing art form. And I can't help but wonder what, you know, pursuing that throughout your you know, young life, throughout your whole life, really, like, what does that do in terms of mental health, you know, and body image? Is there any possible way to really achieve success in that arena without having to grapple with some of those demons?
Ooh, sis. Girl, it's a journey. It's a journey. It's a process. And I mean, I guess I can like tackle this a few different ways as a woman, then as a Black woman. Mm-hmm. So as a woman, we always go through, our bodies fluctuate naturally depending on what time of the month it is or what time of the month it is not. So we already have this, you know, awareness of our bodies in a sense. And I think women already struggle with that. And I think for me specifically, when my body starts to really come in and start to fill out and all that good stuff, the part that I really struggled with was the fact that outside of the dance studio, I knew my body was banging.
Yeah.
Like, let's not front on that. I'm like, I love the booty. I love it to death. And there's nobody on this planet Earth that could make me want to change that. But sometimes ballet did. And that's what I meant in Dance Dreams when I said that the craft that chose me was not created in my image. And that was something that I really had to give myself time with. Because I was constantly, like, especially in college, like, gaining, losing weight. Like, it was honestly and truly something else. And it was definitely something that I struggled with. There was a very dark cloud at a certain point. But at the end of the day, one thing that I had to respect was that no matter what, I'm not going to be able to stop dancing. I can try 1,000 times over, but it's always going to come back to me. And I really got, and it wasn't even during college. It was like a few years after college where I was like, all right, sis, we need to figure it out. What's going to work for you? And it even came down to like what type of strengthening regimens I do for myself. I can't just go to the gym and do squats all day and lift weights and stuff like that, because the way my muscles form, they'll bulk up and right. I'll look bigger than what I, you know, my weight actually is or something like that as a Black woman. And so that's like, for me, I started doing Pilates and gyrotonics and stuff like that. And even to this day, there's not one dance job I will not take on without taking a Pilates class first, because I know my body is healthy. It's moving properly, but also my muscles, I look like a dancer. Like, I don't have to be insecure about that. Even if my booty is a little, you know, on the big side that day.
Yes. Oh my God. I mean, it's so crazy to even imagine you being insecure about what you look like. You know, anyone can see how gorgeous you are. You have a body that so many women, Black women, any women would aspire to have. And then here you are, you know, excelling at your craft, and it's just like not good enough. And I think that even people who maybe, you know, don't do ballet, they find themselves, you know, combating those same thoughts and those same hurdles, right. Whether it's about body image or how smart you are. Like, you work hard and you get to a certain place because you've done so well. And then when you get there, you know, you're picked apart. And I think that is, you know, that is something that we as a society and we as a community really have to wrap our minds around. And that's one thing I think about quarantine. It's kind of allowed people to step back and really have to rely on themselves and their own self images, because there's not really anybody else around to be bouncing right. that image off of. It's really just you, and it's just about getting comfortable. And for you to put it all out there and put it on full display, you know, I wonder what it's like, you know, A, to know what that feels like, and then know that you might be that example, like you might be that aspiration that people feel like I'll never be as good as Kylie. You know, I'll never get a body like Kylie. You know, like, how do you
grasp? See, that's the thing. And that is what I am not here for. I don't want anybody trying to be like Kylie. I want everybody, if to take anything from me, is to be confidently yourself. Because can't nobody do Kylie like Kylie. Period. And that's just what it's going to be always. But in another sense, like, I can never do what another woman can do for herself. I can never, my shine is different from everyone else's. And I think that the more that we learn how to really take back our power and keep it, the less women will, be struggling with, jealousy or their own confidence. Or even if it is a certain day that you're not feeling your best, because you know you're walking in your own light and your own confidence, you can give yourself a moment to say, okay, maybe I've been a little too generous with the cookies this past week. We can reel it back a little bit, or we can twerk it out the next second. Like, you know what I'm saying? But as long as we're comparing ourselves to the next person, I think we're always just kind of setting ourselves up for failure. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? And if there's one thing I would love for people to take away from me is you got to figure it out. You got to figure out what works for you. Because like I said, if I kept just working out in the gym all day doing squats, wouldn't be in this position. Let's be honest. Yeah. You know what I'm saying? I had to figure out what works for me. Yeah. So I hope everybody could take that.